to remind you.
Do you want me to tell you how all-encompassing it's been?
Sure.
Saturday night, I just took a quick glance on the Twitter, and I see, oh, Roberto Luongo got hurt. You know what I immediately do? I drop a goalie and pick up their backup.
And where were you?
I don't know, family dinner.
No fantasy or fancy stats.
Oh, yeah, we get a lot of shots. Everybody comes to the net. We just have to get more and more pucks to the net.
What were you saying about putting pucks on net?
Pucks on net.
Pucks on net.
Continue to put pucks on net.
Pucks on net.
Pucks on net.
Well, that's the key. We got to get the puck on net.
We used to talk about in Vancouver getting pucks on net.
Pucks on net and driving and making a hard night on them.
Live on tape from Geeta's apartment, her palatial estate on the 23rd floor. This is Pucks on Net, a Vancouver hockey podcast that doesn't talk about fantasy or fancy stats. And after the inaugural Pucks on Net fantasy hockey draft, that rule has never been more crucial to keeping this show on the rails. I'm filling some time here. Well, P Mac, he's got a, looks like an egg. Geeta, what kind of sandwich is that to Paul have?
It looks like there's egg in it and sausage.
Mm-hmm.
It's from Starbucks. It's hot because you can see.
It's steamy.
Yeah.
Paul's got a steamy egg sandwich going, and he's given us the seal of approval.
So we'll just keep going.
Yeah, we'll just keep going. My name is Ryan Chapp. I'll be your host for the evening. Riding shotgun is
not quite evening yet, but happy Thanksgiving.
Yeah, it's a stat holiday, which means it's
a brunch cast.
It's 20-1.
Thanks for keeping me from my family, Ryan.
I have to go see my family tonight too. In fact, I'm going to be posting this likely at my cousin's house in Mission, going, I need some Wi-Fi.
Do they have internet in Mission now?
No, I have to bring like a 400 feet of LAN cable, and I got to go to the neighbor's.
It's a good thing you stole all that from Shaw before we left.
And all the copper wiring, too.
A giant satellite dish.
And the VCR.
One of those things was procured from Shaw and not returned. And they, for some reason, they didn't seem to care.
Gave away a lot of stuff, folks. Ryan's not stealing.
Yeah. My name's Ryan. I'll be your host for the evening. Riding shotgun in her palatial estate. She owns this joint. That's Geeta.
Hi.
Fresh off of a James Reimer pickup at a family function. And P-Mac, who just utilized his Starbucks rewards to get himself a hot...
It was a $9 coffee.
That guy looks like he could use a warm meal.
No, I had to pay for the sandwich because the $9 coffee took my free points.
Paul, for the most part, you're quite straight-laced. You're quite an honest guy. You know, you're very... You know, you're happy to pay what's owed. But when it comes to the Starbucks rewards, you like to get every possible bang for your buck.
How many shots of that almond syrup are in your cup?
Do they charge extra for syrup? I should have gotten more shots of syrup, too. Extra espresso, twice as much as you normally get.
I've seen Paul in the summer get like a $9 smoothie. And it's one of the most impressive things I've seen is just you using the system fully to your advantages.
An extra banana in there, you get some extra protein in there, some blackberries.
I wouldn't even know how to create a drink that Paul has.
It's the app. You got to use the app to do it.
It's like he's writing computer code when he does it.
No, I'm looking at two other apps.
I want to thank
and I mean my two fantasy apps.
Oh, okay. That's a lot more. That's funnier. I like that. Well, thank you for joining us, Herbie Gostar. Make sure you follow us on Twitter. If you haven't done that yet, I've said this about 265 times, and every now and then we have listeners that have been listening for a while that just follow us now. So please follow us on Twitter at pucksonetca or pucksonetca. And
where we're just as funny.
Yes. I had a couple of really, really good tweets this week that just blew up about Pettersson. Eli Pettersson. We'll get there in a second. And if you want to support the show monetarily, pledge a couple of bucks, upwards of as much as you want, minimum of five, please. Head on over to patreon.com/pucksonnet, where you do pledge a couple of bucks, and then you get access to all our bonus stuff.
Has that payment from Jimmy Pattison gone through? I heard he was going to give us $4,000 a month.
Imagine all the content.
If we were making $4,000 a month, you guys would be a lot busier during the week. We'd have a Wednesday night Patreon fantasy show, a Thursday night gear up for the weekend.
We're live from Jimmy Pattison's garage. It's Pucks on Net. Ryan's been let go. I'm your host, Paul McKellen.
Jimmy Pattison wrote the check to me, not to him. We boxed him out. That is my nightmare. That's what kept me up at night. I don't want to segue now. We just were wrapping up all our Jimmy Pattison Patreon bonus stuff, non-talking about fantasy. Geeta, you're going to tell your children, your grandchildren, 40 years from now, when you're 65.
I saw Elias, whatever he wants to go by.
It's the shoulder shrug after his name.
I saw Pettersson score his very first goal with my own two eyes.
So we are reveling, we are enjoying, we are praising Elias P Mac.
I'm still doing Elias. I don't get it.
They call him Elias in the arena, don't they?
They call him about 7 different other things.
They compare him to everyone.
It reminds me of when Tyler Benson, who is now a second round underachieving prospect for the Oilers, was drafted first overall in the Bantam draft for junior.
Right.
And on the cover of the province, it said, Orr, Lemieux, Howe, Gretzky, Crosby, Messier, like, Benson? Question mark.
Been compared to all those people and LeBron James.
Yeah, he's Paul Kariya. Yeah. He has a better shot than Wayne Gretzky, which makes him better.
A lot of people have been throwing around Joe Sakic, who I think, you know, just because of his build and his shot, might be a decent comparison. And
his
he plays defense
build
pretty
is
well
gonna
too.
Change.
Well, Joe Sakic filled out enough after his first few years in the league too, but he was a tall, slim fella, big shot, played good defense. I think that's the best comparison I've heard so far.
It's a fair one, but it's just...
I mean, it's what we get to be seen, but like if he pans out, that would probably be your best case scenario.
But right now, 2 games in against the Calgary Flames, he looks really pretty out there.
Hey, those Calgary Flames are going to be good. I wrote about them.
I mean, they won on Saturday night.
Yeah, that was the Calgary Flames that should have played, and then I don't know what happened on Wednesday night. But yeah, he looks really good, and he works hard, and like he's not just Brock. He's not just sitting there looking to score goals. He plays center. He back checks. Mm-hmm. He's hard on every play. Like he's so fun to watch.
Mm-hmm. And Papa Pettersson in the crowd. He should be the Canucks' new hype man.
Is also really fun to watch.
If it was the UK, he would have been flipping off the folks around him. But no,
is that what that is?
I don't know exactly how it sits, but 2 fingers backwards at someone. I don't know if it goes back to victory or it goes back to. I've still got my fingers. If you were an archer, they'd cut your fingers off. That's so it was a way to be like, I've still got my fingers.
And that's what that's how you taunt Joe Sakic after that.
All right. Well.
Oh, that's a reference you haven't made here before.
Oh, I've made some snowblower references on this show before.
He's still got all his fingers.
Yeah, those new robot fingers, they're very fast.
It's like Star Wars.
Just watch him play fantasy hockey. Everybody was getting kind of, not up in arms, but concerned because Travis Green had him playing about 9 minutes a night.
Well, for night 1, how many did he get night 2?
He played 12 minutes in the third period alone.
I mean, night 1, I think you brought it up in the text, but yeah, it also crossed my mind. They were killed off 7 penalties over the course of the night, and you're not playing Pettersson on the kill. You got Tyler Mott out there for 25 minutes or whatever he played. Yeah. Him and Sutter.
Yeah,
just played leagues more than any other forwards.
Captain-like performances in the penalty kill there. Actually, Brandon Sutter scored a goal.
He scores goals. People forget this. Like, he's got a decent, accurate shot. It's other things I think people have issues with his game. They're not looking for offense.
Mm. Like his Fortnite efforts?
Yes. Mm. Yes, right.
Yeah, that's a problem. That's cause for concern.
Him and Bo are really slacking in that department.
It would help with their hand-eye coordination.
Well, yeah. I think Brock needs to play it a bit more. He's
Who's scoring these goals? You got Jake Virtanen.
Fortnite.
Elias Pettersson.
Probably Fortnite.
Nikolay Goldobin.
Definitely Fortnite.
You got, what's his name, Eriksson out there playing his retro SNES in his hotel room every night after games.
If he's listening, and I know he is, if his SNES breaks and he can't get the SNES Classic, I've got Geeta's back at my house, and we can give it to him. If, you know, he loses his Super Nintendo.
I think your next Patreon episode is us playing Fortnite.
Do any of us have the appropriate hardware
to play?
I don't
know. We can figure it out.
I know some associates and cronies. I would love to do that. Just go in blind and record.
I've got NHL 94 on Super Nintendo. That might be.
I've got 93 on Sega.
You have 94?
I've got 94 and 96.
Where is it?
At my house.
Can you bring it?
I've got to check, actually. I'm not sure if I have the Super Nintendo. I have the NES.
But
I think I've got the Super Nintendo. My brothers will have it if I don't.
Well, you're going out to White Rock tonight. Why don't you poke around?
Don't tell people where my family lives.
Since we've just gone off the rails, do you happen to have the 64 as well?
Yeah, I have.
Okay.
I have Geeta's Super Nintendo and her Nintendo 64, which came delivered to me in a gym bag from the 1998 NHL All-Star Game in, wait for it, Vancouver. So I need you to go home, and if you can.
It belongs to my brother, not to me.
Now you're trying to keep your street cred there. I like that. I had to.
I was at the 1998 fan. What did they call it back then? The fandemonium or something?
That's where the bag came from.
it was a good time. I saw Peter Bondra from a distance.
I need you to see if you can track down NHL 94 because I've reached out to. I reached out to a former Flame because I know she had some Super Nintendo games and she only had.
Oh, I thought you meant like an actual Flame.
Yeah, no, yeah. So did I. I was like, she that played for the Flames?
Marion Rayon had a quick stint in Flames training camp.
That year they used 8 goalies in the regular season.
It was down to her and Brathwaite and they went with Brathwaite. Anyway, I asked her what game she had, but she only has NHL PA 93, which isn't the good one. Mm.
I've got 94 and 96.
Okay, so we're going to need, next week, I'm going to need to get those off you.
I'm not giving you anything. You've still got all of Geeta's stuff from like 4 years ago.
I just got it. It was, Dave had it before.
That doesn't make it better. I will bring it, we can play it together, and then I will leave with it as well.
Are you going to go home and play it?
Sometimes.
When's the last time you played it?
I don't remember. It doesn't matter.
Sure, right. It's yours.
Exactly.
I'll give you $4 for it.
Super Nintendo
sounds
is my favorite
system.
Sounds
like a family dinner. Really sorry, listeners.
All right, let's talk about some real hockey.
It's been fun to watch hockey again. It's been lopsided. It's been high scoring. It's been no defense if you've been watching the Toronto Maple Leafs.
Mm-hmm. Was it 7-6?
It was a 7-6 final in overtime.
Yeah, I was watching the end of that one. There were like 5 goals in the last 4 minutes of action.
It's mind-boggling what's happening with that Maple Leafs team. Like, you can't, like... But I'm really forgetting. I really forgot how long the season is. And like all these players went on the IR this week. Like Jumbo's on IR for his knee being infected and like.
Inflamed. I don't think it's infected, is it?
There is an infection and he's on antibiotics. That's what I heard this morning. But like Jonathan Quick's on IR. And you think like if you're in that not. If you've spent the early part of these last few months in a different mindset where maybe they only play 16 regular season games, you're like, oh my God, Jonathan Quick injured? There goes the season. And you're like, oh wait, there's 80 games left in the season. They're probably going to be just fine.
Yeah.
Loui Eriksson was supposed to miss the first month, according to Ryan's prediction, and then his injury, and now he's back and
I was
leading the team in assists or whatever.
Well, he's
on track for the 20. Yeah.
He's on track for about 100 assists this season.
No, you know what's going to happen, Loui Eriksson? He's no longer going to be, oh man, I'm kind of hurt again. I need to wait this one out. He's going to play through the pain because he's got two young boys that are going to keep him relevant
for
the next.
That's the thing. You're not giving up that spot to somebody else.
Oh no, that's a spot that he's got his old man Swedish claws in that spot. And he's not giving it up for anybody.
You've got to make sure the kids don't slump.
Coach Travis Green came out and said the ban on video games is not from him. So if Bo comes up to the hotel suite and Loui Eriksson's playing Chrono Trigger to his heart's content, he can tell Bo to just go F off. I've got more points than you right now, Bo.
I feel like Bo doesn't put fear into Eriksson.
Well, I don't think anybody puts fear in Eriksson. Have you seen that guy's face? He's just like, no. I'm still trying not to swear on the show, but swear. Nothing given.
He's like, he's fresh out of ifs to give. He doesn't give an F.
There you go.
I love saying not giving an F, but that's him. He's like, man, and he's going to go up to that room with the Fortnite boys, and they're going to be like, oh, be quiet. Put the towel under the door so they can't hear. He's like, who the fuck cares? As he cracks a beer or something.
Yeah.
And he's like, yeah, I love Fortnite. And he's just mashing the keypad. Like, this is a great game.
Kids, don't leave. We keep playing. I don't know why he's rushing now.
Oh, for
Nikolay, sit down. We're playing Fortnite. Bo can sit on third line for all I care. I don't know why I made him an old Russian man. That's just my go-to European hockey player accent.
That's Goldobin. He's such a grizzled vet now.
No, Goldobin's the one like, I don't think we should be doing this, guys.
Oh, and Gold... Anytime...
And Eriksson's like, sit down. We're playing games.
In those three goals...
Way to divide the dressing room, Paul.
New captain, Loui Eriksson.
Hey, all of a sudden, I kind of like this Loui Eriksson character.
You know,
all he had to do was put up a couple of assists.
Can we talk about the captaincy? I don't think anybody questioned Bo being the captain at all until this stupid video game thing came up. And he was on the radio talking about Fortnite. Like, somebody tweeted like it was crack cocaine. It was like, I just know that I've never done it. And I hope the kids and parents are listening at home because I've never done it and I never will do it.
So you bring
that uppity attitude isn't endearing.
No, that's not a captain. Like, maybe you take a hard stance, but you don't go on the air saying video games are like drugs.
Stay in school, kids. Make sure you study for cap
class.
That's
a little too deadly. Brian just
EA
gave me
Sports
this
is never reaching out to Bo.
He's never going to be the cover.
Oh, no. Ryan gave me this big Dudley Do-Right like lead in earlier in the show, but Bo is like that. Overshooting the market when he's making those comments. And I think it's just because he's a kid. I don't think he's a bad guy. I don't think he's a narc. I just think he's a kid who's trying to say the right things to impress coaches and management.
When
he
I make
really a, wanted to see.
When I make a clickbait article for this week's podcast, it's going to say PMAC : Bo's a narc.
No, I said I don't think he's a narc.
I can edit this.
Oh, jeez.
I don't. He's a narc. When that came out, this for those that are not in the Vancouver market, little backstory. The Fortnite thing has been a topic, and I guess it was before the regular season, and it was just a simple, you know, question.
Was it Michael Delzato? One of those guys originally was just like, oh, I don't think we should be playing. Some of the guys should be playing so many video games on the road. Says the guy who spends all his time on his computer remixing, Shania Twain songs or whatever.
But I guess Bo saw this as an opportunity who's not yet, there's no captain for the Canucks. He's one of the A's. It's his first year with a letter.
Right.
And he's the, in my mind, I'm thinking, this is my chance to really step up and, you know, give it my all and tell people what's what and show that I'm a leader, a vocal, dominant leader. And he says this and he's like, video game, you know, they're dumb. We're in all these great cities. You should go, not be cooped up in your room.
Remember what happened to Hamilton when he started talking about going to museums on the road?
They shipped him out of town.
Be careful, Bo. If you like it, maybe he doesn't like it here. Maybe he wants to go to Carolina.
So when
they're doing okay this week.
When this came out, you, Paul, and I were texting, and he's like, I can't believe that I can't believe that Bo Horvat. He sounds like a sucking up to be the a kid sucking up in Sunday school. I'm like, what are you talking about? Like, he's making a valid point that maybe is a little not clearly thought out. And then he directs me to the attention of another interview he did where he basically gave an anti-drug PSA. Like, I don't do I don't do video games. I never have. This is your brain. This is your brain on video games.
It went from being like, there are other things you should be focused on the road, and we should be bonding as a team on the road to listen. It was the lead-in that really got me. Listen, I hope I hope parents and kids at home are listening. It's not something I do or will ever do. I'm paraphrasing, but not by much. It was addressed to the good kids and parents at home. Don't do Fortnite, not even once. And I was like, I don't play video games. I don't care.
Listen, I know that.
But that sounds like I grew up in a religious community where some people would be like, oh, you're going to go home and watch the hockey game on Sunday afternoon. You shouldn't be watching television on Sundays. It's the Lord's Day. Or are you drinking Coca-Cola with caffeine? That is not okay in the sight of the Lord. And it just sounded like one of those on... Oh, I thought it was Sunday. It's Monday because it's holiday week. It's one of those where it's just like... Oh, you're playing Fortnite after the game instead of going out for a beer with the boys? That's not what you should be doing on, who are we saying's day? Gordie Howe's day. Game day.
In Gordie Howe's day, he would smoke a pack of cigarettes, eat a steak and donut sandwich, and then not do any cardio and... Oh, it's game time. Let's go. That's how things we're done.
That's how hockey players should spend their days off on the road.
Well, I mean, you should be able to do both. This is not a conversation of what's better or what is a better way to bond and be friends with people. It's a matter of self-control.
You guys play a lot of video games.
I don't play any video games.
You took my video games. You played for like 8 hours.
And you tried to take mine even though I don't play my video games.
But a couple of weekends ago, did you not bond with the guys?
Yeah, we played Mario Kart for like 2 hours straight.
There you go. But
I also know how addictive things are. I remember when in grade 11, I rented a PS2 and played Grand Theft Auto Vice City for 16 hours straight one day. The sun came up and down. And I'm not a video games person, so it's all about self-control.
Mm-hmm. That's a fair argument, and if that was the argument Bo was making, you know, whatever.
But you would think that these guys who are professional athletes should have that discipline.
And if they don't, you probably don't want them on your team.
Yeah.
But my issue in the end is just like, if Bo is going to be the future captain of this team, he needs to be careful with how he talks about, you know, the pastimes of teammates. Because if somebody else becomes the favorite, if Elias Pettersson is now the favorite at the end of the season to get the C because he's going to get 160 goals.
What about Loui?
Hold up there. If this other kid comes and he says, I like to play Fortnite and I got 160 goals, and these guys that go out for a beer after the game and hang out together in person, they're not getting 160 goals a night. They should be home playing Fortnite like that's good boys, Nikolay and I, that are 200-point players.
And our dad, Loui.
Yes. Loui in the corner with his... SNES Retro.
No, he's gonna have a PS4 controller, but it's not gonna be turned on or plugged. He's like, I'm playing. It's like when you would trick your little kid. Oh yeah, you can play too, and it's not plugged in or on.
Yeah, no.
Oh,
anyway.
That's how you let me podcast. Yeah. My mic's not plugged in.
A few weeks when Geeta's not on the show, she is here.
It'd be
interesting to see if that's what happens.
The thing that made it look bad was. Travis Green went out in the media after Bo was defiant in his words and
don't listen to him.
Yeah, and he goes, yeah. And they basically did
He actually laughed at it.
That's why I felt so bad for Bo, because he's like, my kids play Fortnite, and I have not banned it from him, and I'm not banning it from anyone on our team. And it's just
which supersedes anything Bo said.
Listen, Bo's gonna get a little excited from time to time. He means well. He's trying his best. And so I went from, give this kid the C to, okay, he's going to have some growing pains shooting his mouth off.
Which maybe is a good thing now that in retrospect that they didn't give him the C. Now he has to work his way to that and prove it.
I don't think that's the only reason, but there's a lot of things. People get so up in arms about the captaincy. And we talked a bit about Weber with the Canadians last week and the captaincy and how these players get chosen. Yeah. And I think we forget a lot of the reasons these players are given letters happen behind closed doors that fans and media never get to see. And there may be a few things where Bo shows his age. He looks like he's 30 years old, but he's not 30 years old.
No.
And he probably says a couple things. We all say things when we're 21, 22 years old that later on we go, oh, what was I doing
there? You just don't know how to handle a interpersonal relationship as well at that age.
So when you're handing someone a mantle like that, where guys like Loui Eriksson are expected to look to them as sort of a point person in the locker room, and they start rolling their eyes, and other young players might start rolling their eyes as well, it's good probably in the end not to give the C. And not giving anyone the C is probably their way of saying, like, we still really like Bo. It's just no need to put that pressure on him right now.
Exactly. So don't hand him the C, but maybe hand him a controller.
Yeah. Here you go. Loui will teach you how to play.
Pull up a chair. Some nights we go to the museum. Some nights we play Fortnite. That sounds great to me.
Hey, Dave, thoughts on Bo shooting his mouth off in the media last week about his Fortnite ban?
I don't hear anything that happens in Vancouver anymore.
That's Dave calling from Ottawa, fresh off. What was that, an Oshawa Generals game? Kingston Frontenacs? No,
I was at the Kingston Frontenacs versus the Barry Colts game yesterday at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, Easter time. So that's like 6 a.m. for you guys.
Yeah.
And when, a little Thanksgiving hockey with the Admansky family. Cousin Alan was doing the color last night or yesterday afternoon, and so I had a seat with his father James and cousin Francis, and we took in a little bit of afternoon puck. The Fronts are pretty bad this year.
This is the OHL minute with Dave McPhail.
Yeah, the Ontario Hockey League, bud. We sat we sat across from a Winnipeg Jet scout. Who was looking at the younger Suzuki, who plays for the Barry Colts. Nobody in Kingston were scouting. But Dale Howardchuk's kid, Glenn Howardchuk, or whatever the hell his name is, and Suzuki were the guys that he was looking at. And it was fun. It was good to see a different brand of junior hockey other than the old Vancouver Giants.
Yeah, people actually care about junior hockey out there. It's kind of a different world.
They really do. It's really a thing. But the Kingston faithful really got to tone it down on the Doug Gilmore and Gord Downie tributes, which is like every 5 seconds in the arena, in case you didn't know where you were.
This power play is brought to you by the Tragically Hip.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they have a different Tragically Hip song for pretty much any in-game situation over there. It's pretty great. But although I got to say, I heard the best road goal, like deflating out of the building road goal song I've heard ever in my life at hockey. When Barry put the game away with a shorthanded goal to make it 4-2 in the third, they went with the Seinfeld theme song.
Oh!
Which just fit very, very nicely. Kudos to the audio guy in Kingston. I don't know why that was so funny, but it just worked.
You know what would be even better is if there was a big fumble or a big mistake and they did the Curb Your Enthusiasm theme song, but then I think they might get fired.
Yeah, that's a fireable offense. Another thing that I saw in my Dave Does Ontario minute was Friday night. I went to my first Rod Blacks game with a couple of the boys from the Swamp Duckies from my new hockey team. And that was fun. I actually understand why people like the Canadian Football League outside of Vancouver. Regular, non-mouth-breathing, alien-looking folks go to football games outside of Vancouver. It's not just the King George Station crowd that attend the games.
Mouth-breathers, please send your tweets to Puckson Dave if you want to argue the fact that you're not a mouth-breather.
It's not that Fraser Valley leper colony coming out to BC Place.
Whoa, a couple of us grew up down in that area there.
Yeah, but none of us went to BC.
I know,
that's
yeah,
the Lions clientele.
None of you spend a lot of time there anymore. Dave,
we'll get you back off your OHL and CFL minute because you had a very interesting theory about Willie Nylander and what he's doing right now.
Yeah, now he's playing it. If he wants to stay in Toronto, he's playing a very, very dangerous game, and it gets more dangerous by the minute. And since the last time I tweeted about it, it got even more interesting with the touchdown over the touchdown without a single point victory that Toronto pulled over Chicago last night. A game that they would have lost if basically anybody but Cam Ward had been in net, let's be honest.
Hey, that guy's got a Conn Smythe, pal.
To be fair, he had played 3 games in 4 nights and looked pretty good the other 2 nights he was playing. So
he did?
Yeah, they Forsberg went down with injury before the first game of the season, so their fourth stringer is backing him up, so they played him 3 nights
in
four.
Oh, my God.
So,
hey, but at tax time, Paulie, that backup is one hell of an accountant, okay? So anyway, that being said, yeah, fine, Cam Ward's tired, whatever. They still give up 6 goals, like, to not Colonel McElhaney, you know, like, I know Don Cherry went off on a rant on that on Saturday. Turns out he knows a thing or two about hockey. But there's an interesting development there in that this team has proven very, very obviously that goals are not going to be the problem this year. Between those two lines, between the Matthews Marner and Marlowe line and Tavares with basically whoever you want because he's so good. their scoring is not going to be the problem. They're going to put up plenty of goals. Nylander could sit out all season. He can go play in Sweden. It doesn't matter. But one thing that we have seen is that they give up a lot of goals. Montreal and Ottawa, both not very good teams, both put up over 30 shots against Toronto. and kept the zone time pretty maxed out.
It's almost like you're suggesting they might need a help on the back end?
A help on the back, yeah, maybe, you know, and that's what, you know, Nylander, the more he holds out, the more they realize they don't need what he brings to the team, which is, again, like, you know, between 50 and 60 points. Maybe they need some help on the back end. And this is one of those rare situations in hockey where a couple of general managers could get together and not only help each other out.
Oh, conspire.
But conspire to set up a date with each other in June, where there is a match here to be made, East and West, where both teams would benefit in a big, big way. And again, this theory gained more traction by the hour as the New York Islanders just blanked the San Jose Sharks 4-0. San Jose has Erik Karlsson, and they have Brent Burns. They've got Justin Braun. They've got Marc-Edouard Vlasic. It's about as good as a defense as it gets. Jumbo Joe Thornton shaves off his beard, weakens his immune system, and gets injured right away.
We were just talking about that earlier. Yeah, he's on the antibiotics. Who would have thought the beard would be so impactful?
It's like a filter. It just catches all that bacteria. Anyway.
Samson Lake.
Yeah.
Except the fact that he was injured with a giant beard half of last year, too.
Hey, we don't know that.
Yeah. Hey, that's old news. Okay. Anyway. There's a trade here to be made. These two teams, it's a marriage made in heaven. If Doug Wilson would show the initiative being the senior member of the GM club and called up skinny little dweeb Kyle Dubas and goes, if I got a deal for you, you need defense, I got defense. My team can't score, you've got a guy who can score. I see a fit here with Marc-Andre Vlasic, slightly overrated because he gets to play those minute-munching penalty kills for Team Canada in the big tournament.
You say Marc-Andre?
Whatever his name is. I don't know. Edward, Andre, it's all French. It doesn't matter. But he would be a great fit in Toronto. He's exactly what they need. They've got a couple puck movers in Gardner and Morgan Riley.
But they're just that. They're just puck movers. They're not exactly...
They're not going to shut anybody down. They're not going to keep Taves and Kane within at least 3 points a game each. They can't get to five, okay? Just three. That's all you need. You need a Band-Aid. You don't need a big stopgap.
I'm just not sure. As far as San Jose as a trading partner, until they've locked up, if they can, Erik Karlsson long-term, I don't know if they'll move a defenseman because I'm not sure they're as confident with their depth. And they've got a lot of young forwards coming up, like Meyer and the like. So they're pretty deep up front. I wonder if Winnipeg might be a potential match for them as well. They've got a lot of depth on the blue line. They've got a lot of depth up front, too, but they're the type of team that wouldn't mind adding another young horse to the stable.
Conservative Paulie.
You know.
Well, you make a good point, Paul.
And those two teams could meet in the final and guarantee the Canadian winner.
You make a good point, Paul. If it's not all our chips are in the middle, holy shit, it's Stanley Cup or bust in San Jose. Joe Thornton is like a 1,000 years old. And Joe Pavelski ain't getting any younger. You've got Couture
just in the prime of his career.
you've got Kane in his prime. It's like Pavelski's like 34. He's past his prime. This is like he's starting the downslide now. But my point is, with Karlsson and Burns, the
fact checkers are going off.
If not now, when? This is your chance.
Like, yeah, but they have to.
No. Forget next year. Next year doesn't matter. You got to go for it now. And they can't score goals. And the Leafs have a guy that can. And they have to give up a piece of something that they already have. This makes more sense in the world than anything. Winnipeg, I disagree, because Jacob Trouba, it's like every year, is he going to be on the team or not? I don't think, unless it's Trouba that they trade, which, again, that could make sense. I could see that. San Jose and Toronto are perfect for each other. They can help each other out. And if they do this deal, I say you could book it in June and May. It's going to be that long-ass plane flight Stanley Cup series.
San Jose also needs some defensive defensemen back. They don't want to turn into the Toronto Maple Leafs here, giving up, you know, all these Rovers that don't play D. I don't see that being impossible, but, like, I have trouble seeing them give up Vlasic right now. He's a cement anchor on that blue line right now to cover up for these Rovers.
You got two guys who won Norris trophies on your blue line.
Because they give the Norris to guys that are offensive defensemen.
I would flip this argument on you, Paul, and say, yeah, you've only got Karlsson for one season. So, again, like I said, if not now, when? You got to go for it. And they can't score enough right now. But you can't get more than three goals against teams like Los Angeles. They're not showing me enough that they have enough. They don't have enough firepower right now.
They add one more winger.
Because, like, right now you've got... You can put, when Thornton's healthy, you can put Thornton with with Couture and say you put Thomas Hertl there, you need someone to get Evander Kane the puck on a, in a 5-on-5 situation.
They got Kane playing on the third line right now. They got a lot of depth on that team.
They just got to figure it out.
They have depth, but Nylander really could boost them up front. Also, with William Nylander, I'm going off on a bit of a tangent here, but back on the Nylander front.
A tangent? Never.
Never. I only get 5 minutes on this show now, so I'm just going to interrupt everybody.
It's been five. 10.
With Nylander, I don't know. I Paul, you can fact check it right now. It'd be nice to know who his representative is. I think it might be Pat Frisson. I could be wrong. But I think he's getting bad advice because he's being told to hold out for this deal. He's not even the first best player on that team. He's not the second best player on that team. He's not the third best player on the team. He might be the fourth best player they have. Maybe.
Yeah.
So I don't know where the hell he gets off thinking he deserves more than other guys in the same situation as him have gotten. I think he's getting bad advice.
You got to remember his old man is also pretty hands-on with him, and that's the thing I've heard. And but you can't get mad. You can't discredit Nylander when the GM and Brendan Shanahan are more or less promoting that everybody should take hometown discounts so that they don't have to regret signing Patrick Marleau so that they can re-sign Mitch Marner and Austin Matthews. And if you're Nylander, you're going, okay, well, why don't you give me what I'm worth? But instead, you need to give me less because these two guys you think are better and more important than me. So it's
The biggest problem I have with that is it's pretty hypocritical because if you look back on Brendan Shanahan's career, he never took a hometown discount for anybody.
Absolutely. That's how we did it back in Detroit. And I'm like, you guys were the highest paid.
Even relative to teams now, they were higher paid at points.
Yeah.
If you converted it to 2018 dollars, that would be like a $150 million salary cap team. And that's not an exaggeration.
Possibly like, more, yeah.
They had Yankee payroll. Overtime playing a checking line role because they could. For Shanny to go out and say something like that and shoot his mouth off, I disagree with that. But, like, I don't know. Paul brings up a good point. Winnipeg, I could see a match there with Trouba. Like, sure. But, like, I just think that San Jose and Toronto, if they got this done, it strengthens. My point is not, like, that there's other trading partners that these guys could get together with. It's that would be a trade in one of those rare instances where no one's trying to swindle anybody. And this would really help both clubs a lot, at least in the short term.
Yeah, I agree with you, Dave. But and on that high note, we will we'll bounce you off the Skype. And it was a pleasure this week.
All right, I'll talk to you guys next week. I'll keep an eye on the Kitchener Rangers situation.
Oh, good. We're really concerned about the Rangers and if they have the depth to really go challenge for the President's Cup or whatever it's called there. Yeah.
And on Saturday night,
we're really only here for the London Knights.
Yes. Right. I can't afford London Knights tickets. That's the big leagues.
All right, Dave. We'll talk to you later, bud.
Next week when I talk to you guys, I'll summarize my trip out to Canada.
Oh, good.
I'll be attending my first Ottawa Senators game on Saturday against the LA Kings.
You know when your uncle or aunt comes back from a trip and it's like, we've got like just like 400 photos we've got to show you. That's you today. See you, bud.
All right, bye.
Chatty Kathy.
Dear Diary. Oh, I don't keep a diary. I'm going to do it on the podcast. No, I don't.
Does Dave listen to the podcast still? Because
I think he was really excited about the things he did this week.
Everybody is. And we did fact check. Let it be said, Dave was right for one thing. Joe Pavelski is 34.
Yes, he is.
I just lose track of how old some of these Sharks are relative to Joe Thornton.
Well,
Joe Pavelski looks like a young 25-year-old standing next to old as dirt Joe Thornton.
Joe without the beard looks like he just got traded from Boston. Without the old man hobo beard, he doesn't age.
It's true. He's a very handsome man. I always wondered, I hide my face behind this giant beard because I'm just not as good looking as Joe Thornton.
Like, baby you're just fishing for compliments.
Jesus Christ. Paul, you come in here with your nice sweater and your well-done hair. He looks like a mountain man fresh out of his cabin in Vermont. He goes, oh.
Just a little bit of snow on. Yeah.
Where did you? I bought some just to have that look. It's an aesthetically pleasing. That was a good rant. I do agree with both you and Dave, by the way.
You agree with us both.
It's like he never left.
You know, you make a good point, but you've got to understand that they're taking a gamble, and they've already taken a gamble on Carlson.
I don't know the Sharks well enough to know if they're confident enough with their 5-7 guys to give up a Vlasic.
Yeah, because
their D isn't it's amazing, but it's also heavily leaning towards the offensive defenseman. And that's, Toronto's got a good D for offensive defensemen. Mm-hmm. And then they're letting guys blow past them in 7-6 games. They're
old time hockey.
Different types of players back there.
That's just how it was back then, Paul. You score 13 goals in a game and you go have a cigarette.
Scoring is
it's
up
also
in the league.
Two games in.
I know, everybody's like,
I know,
oh
we're
my
all
God,
so
this
thirsty.
Is the season.
Yeah. Like I said, Jonathan Quick, he's gonna be hurt for 2 weeks. Oh my God.
But yeah, scoring is up this week. We'll see if that keeps up long term. Maybe Toronto's just playing the style of hockey you have to play in today's NHL.
But that's
we'll
the thing. Maybe
out.
Just like the fans, they're very excited.
I'm just, it's just this weird little microcosm where anything happens. And then the Canucks are going to play a Tuesday nighter in Carolina. And it's just going to be
at 4 o'clock our time.
Yeah. It's just and the worst games are those roadies in Carolina. But like, and we're going to get right back to boring hockey. And then it's just every night. Mm-hmm. It's just, you know, like
Carolina got 8 last night.
Who's there? Isn't Scott Darling in net for them?
Who is starting for them this year? Scotty's in their system, but I feel like somebody else. I could be wrong.
No, I think it's him, but
I don't watch Carolina Hurricanes games.
I
well,
mean,
now
be
I might
on TV tomorrow.
Yeah,
I don't have any of them in my pool, so why would I watch them?
I got Hamilton.
Oh, you guys are the worst. Not talking about their stats, just that you know them, you're aware of them.
Those are really the only names I can really name.
I can really respect a guy who spends his time in Vancouver at the art gallery.
That's why that's why he's my favorite Carolina.
Well, he's learned.
Hurricane.
He's cultured.
I was going to say Panther.
Carolina Panther. Now they have a problem with scoring. There was some old time hockey over the... Oh, one more thing about Fortnite, because that's what we were doing. Patrick Laine, who is a noted video game enthusiast.
Yeah.
He's also pretty good at hockey.
Right.
He chimed in with the most delightful ice burn that you could give to the Canucks. He's like, they just need something to blame after last year.
In regards to the video game ban.
But then he also went on to say that the players amongst the Jets have agreed that if they start playing like Vancouver, they'll stop taking their PlayStations on the road.
And then you kind of just want to high five him.
Well, yeah, and then they go to the starchy vanilla ice cream Canucks dressing room, and it's like, what do you think of that? And they're like, oh, it's not our business, you know. Like, there's no sense of humor.
It's funny that you took it that way, where I was more like, it's sort of like me looking at the situation. I know I got fired up about it today, but overall, I've just been like, why do people care about this either way?
Exactly.
And so when they went to the players, I took it as just like, I'm not talking about this anymore. This is dumb. Like, but other people are like, oh, this means when the Jets come to town, it's going to be this amazing. They're going to go after Patrick Laine, and everyone will be bloodied, and it'll be amazing.
No, these are people who care about video games. They're not going to go after anybody and beat anybody up. They don't think gamers are the types to pick fights with people?
Over a headset, yeah.
Bo's going to skate over to him and say, thanks for taking my side, Patrick.
He's like, shut up, nerd. No, this is what's going to happen. The Jets are in town. Guys, everybody come close. Jake Virtanen's going to kill Patrick Laine tonight. He's going to kill him at the center ice in the name of the Vancouver Canucks. We're going to witness something crazy.
And at worst, he's going to skate over to him and be like, you, me, after the game tonight, Fortnite, be there.
Yeah.
That's what's going to happen.
This is my username.
Yeah. Add me as a friend.
Peach Pie's Abby69. I did learn the big Fortnite. I think it was Botchford went in and talked to the Canucks, and it was like Besser, Stetcher, Hutton, and Virtanen are the big players.
Okay.
Besser is a player.
He's not scoring any goals.
I don't know if that has to do anything with his Fortnite game.
Oh, I think
it'd be interesting if it did, but I think that's more training and injury recovery.
That's true.
And being stuck with that old stodgy Bo Horvat at center.
Maybe he just doesn't know what to do against the Flames. It's fine.
There's some old time, along with the high scoring, there was some old time hockey that happened this week.
Oh, what do you mean by that?
Fisticuffs.
Yep, there were fights.
Erica Branson broke.
I also saw
Travis
that happen.
Harmonic due to the century's face.
Were you just kind of like, oh my, or were you like, oh yeah? What type of fist pump did you do?
Good question. I probably applauded politely.
Like a golf clap. Very good face mashing, Eric. That Travis Harmonic is a bad fella.
Now, I watched most of the game, both games for the Canucks, but maybe wasn't paying as much attention. Did Dalton Prout go after Erik Gudbranson at any point on Saturday night? After all that hype, after all that lead up.
It was all hype.
And I'm glad it was, because it was a borderline hit, but not that bad. After the game, Erik Gudbranson said, you know what? Wasn't the cleanest hit. I apologize. It was a kid, you know, whatever. But that's, you got to play that game. And he fought the guy that came after him afterwards.
He even went to Dylan Dubé, who was playing his first NHL game. And he like apologized more or less and said, hey, you know, that was on me. I'm not looking to hurt you out here. And like, that's kind of like when I'm like, God, good. That's why we have a guy like Erik Gudbranson on the Canucks have a guy like Gudbranson on the team. And then, Travis Hamonic is going to stand up for a rookie, because that's what you do. And they fought and that was over. And then you had 3 days of, they have some goon that's got 20 NHL fights. That's going to play defense. And I'm like, well, shouldn't they worry about playing defense and not fighting Gudbranson? And I'm like, there is a chain of events in hockey vigilante justice. You hit a rookie in a compromising position. You fight a guy.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, actually, you serve a penalty for that fight, that hit. Then you fight a guy, and then you dust your hands off, and that's that. But now you're going to have even more vigilante justice, because you hurt the guy in the fight for the stand-up. Like, that doesn't add up. So now it's just like, what are we doing here? And outside of like a couple like stares or glances in warm-ups, like nothing happened.
But that's the thing. He owned up to his mistake.
Yeah.
And it's going to happen. It's a long season. Like, that's pretty minor in the grand scheme of things. It wasn't deliberate. He wasn't there to take someone's head out.
And he just like, it's just, that's just, that was just 3 days of beginning of NHL Canadian media hype. They were hyping it up like the, like
we're talking about the code leading into the game.
The code was already respected. Well,
they were saying something like, "What does the code mean today?" Like, I don't know. Is the code really? I think if depending on which player you talk to, there's different codes, and some of them will just laugh in your face if you talk about the code. So I mean, it's one of those things. Like, it's a different era than it used to be. You hope that's sort of what happens with it, what we saw.
Again, it's absolutely a different era. He apologized. Yeah. Like 50 years ago, they're not apologizing to each other.
I wish I hit you harder, kid.
Yeah, nobody went after Elias Pettersson or Troy Stetcher, or, you know, a Canuck player that could have been a target. Yeah.
I think it's all just hype. And like, their defenseman got hurt. You're going to call up a defenseman, and he's probably just in there in the depth chart. Like,
he's their seventh guy who can play, but you probably don't want, you know, night to night being in your lineup.
Yeah.
He's the guy that's going to come in.
Yeah.
He's their Alex Biega.
So the real question is, who's Gudbranson going to injure and fight on Tuesday night, because there's some former Calgary Flames on the Carolina Hurricanes, and there's a code and a vigilante justice that needs to be upheld.
Well,
so
stay away from Hamilton. Yeah, he's probably on Gudbranson's side.
Yeah, Michael Ferland is going to go after them to stand up for his former teammate who stood up for a rookie that he doesn't know.
And amongst all of this, I went and checked out the league leaders a day or two ago, and who's in the top 10 for plus minus in the NHL? Erik Gudbranson.
Jesus H.
And we all know that plus minus is the most important stat.
Which is funny, because he spent a lot of time in the penalty box on Wednesday night.
That kind of helps players with the plus minus. We all know that, yeah, that's the only stat that matters. It's totally, you can't fault it in any way, shape, or form.
You know what? I think of it like it's a fun stat. It's one to, it's just to know. I don't put any stock into it, but if I see that Tyler Seguin's a plus, I don't know, 8, I'm like, oh, good for him.
It's like goals against average. You could face 60 shots against a night like Mark Denny used to, or Roberto Luongo used to when they played for Columbus and Florida. But, you know, don't look at the save percentage. Look at that 6 goals against a night.
Mm-hmm. Jesus Christ, 6 goals on 65 shots a game. He's only making 659 saves a game.
It's definitely his fault.
He's leaking back there.
Anyway, Erik Gudbranson, has been better than I expected.
Two games.
I hope the best for him. I know he's not a perfect defenseman, but you know, it's all about players making small steps forward with this team.
The other vigilante justice, and I'm curious to hear your guys' take on this, because we might disagree in some capacity, but Lars Eller had his face punched twice from Rat Boy Brad Marchand after taunting or gloating in front of the Bruins bench in a 7-0, scoring the 7th goal in a 7-0 blowout. And I'm just curious what your thoughts were on that.
If there's someone that should be policing people misbehaving on the ice surface during an NHL game, it's definitely not Brad Marchand.
Listen, that
because he's coming from a place of experience.
No, he should not be policing. However, if anyone knows bad behavior on the ice, it's Brad Marchand.
The only reason he policed was because Tom Wilson wasn't there to police just as much. That's the argument.
I feel like Marchand would have taken it upon himself regardless.
Do you know Brad Marchand's only had like 8 fights in his NHL career?
Yeah, because doesn't he just kind of run away?
You know, he submarines or he goes for the knees or the jugular or the eyes and then he gets suspended. Mm.
Much like your plus minus argument if you're not there.
Well, he's only got 4 fights, but he's got 790 suspension games suspended. I didn't mind it. I kind of liked it. But I mean,
if it was someone else, would you have liked it? Like,
if somebody had gotten, if Lars Eller had gotten a concussion or gotten hurt or whatever, I don't see it as like the sucker punch that Max Domi did in the preseason because Lars Eller did drop his glove. Like, yes, he got the instigator, but Lars Eller was like, okay, now I have to fight.
Right.
So he goes to fight and he did a really bad job at it and he got popped in the hardest part of the skull. So I feel really bad for Brad Marchand's hand after that. But like to punch somebody in the side of the head and the skull, that really hurts. But I hate to sound like Don Cherry in this moment, but when you're celebrating like that in front of the bench and then shooting your mouth off to said bench in a 7-0 game, like something's going to happen. People are, you know, this is an emotional game and those players were tightly wound and embarrassed on opening night. And
I just find a lot of these, especially when it involves the Bruins, the acts come back where it's like, I guess it's not a Bruins example. I think back to the Florida Panthers game where Daniel Sedin got called a lowlife for pointing at their bench after scoring the overtime winner or whatever. Mm-hmm. And apparently it goes back to somebody did something, said something earlier in the game. And it's one of these where if you're kind of like Brad Marchand, who pretends to kiss his Stanley Cup rings when he comes back to Vancouver, he probably... And I hate to put this, but it's just one of those things where, yeah, if it's that guy and that team, you start to go, was it just saying something back? And then, yeah, okay, you got to answer back for that type of thing. But then how are we taking sides? Should we just say both sides should shut their mouths? And
I agree. Both, like, you shouldn't gloat on a 7-0 goal, and you shouldn't taunt an opposing team's bench in a blowout. I mean, you also shouldn't be Brad Marchand.
So we don't know the whole story. It's one of those where I'm just like, I do prefer to see violence taken out of the game. If they want to take out gloating like that,
hot dogging,
add a suspension or a fine or something to over the top.
No, the NHL is trying to be the fun league. If they put a suspension on gloating,
so then they need to suspend Brad Marchand. They need to decide what they want to be, what they want to allow, and allow that to happen.
Is it the equivalent of like finding an end zone dance? Because remember that had gotten out of hand for a while?
With the pooping a football?
And like the Sharpie mooning. and the whole.
I think that this is just common sense. Like, and it's being respectful to your opponents. You don't rub it in their face, you know. And it's like watching, it's a bat flip. It's watching a home run ball and not doing your trot. Yes, it's an old school approach, but it's also... there should be a level of respect, and that's the kind of thing that we hang our hat on in hockey is like you still respect your opponent. You shake their hand at the end of the game.
Right.
You should respect your opponent and not, you know, rub it in their face. And you have the old curmudgeons that hang their hat on that argument and really make it sound pointless and dusty. But like there is some validity to it.
But it goes back to it's Brad Marchand doing it. Oh, I'm defending the old way of respectful thinking. And then he goes into other cities and taunts the crowd and bench on a regular basis. So argument doesn't hold any.
He doesn't get a double standard.
But what if it was Jake DeBrusk that did it? Exact same situation.
Slightly less bad.
Slightly, okay, I can agree with that.
But yeah, it's you got to decide what's allowable in that sense, and then punish it from really. I am gonna be one of those like, and I know old school. Oh, we gotta have fights in the game. We gotta have this in the game. I'm all for reducing as much of the violence as possible from the game. Yeah. Keep some hitting in there. Mm-hmm. I don't mind the occasional fight, I guess, but
it's
still like the more and more we learn about head injuries.
Right.
Even fights now, I cringe at the same time as I go, oh, this is an exciting point in the game. I'll admit it is. There's a duality there that I'm slowly shifting to one side. The older I get, the more concerned I am with, like, these are kids now, some of them relative to myself, right. And I don't want to see them get their brains rattled.
Well, they're just so much better. They're such better athletes, and they train in, you know, not, you know, for all you know, they're training in some sort of combat or something, and they're stronger and they're faster and they hit harder. And in a fight, you know, you could have a Vander Kane who knocked out Matt Cook, remember back in the day, which, well, didn't feel too bad about, but, like, players are a lot tougher, or not tougher, but they're just stronger and better at fighting now, and it's a little more dangerous. But
that being said, there's less fighting in the game than ever, I'm pretty sure. I'll have to double check the numbers on that. So
good. We didn't have any problem with Gudbranson fighting.
But
I mean, that wasn't the topic of conversation.
No, but you're saying, like, there's, you don't want to see, you want to see fighting less
because
and less.
Because we're so used to it, right? This is the hockey we know where there's fighting.
Yeah, it's so great, isn't it?
But Paul's got a point.
I also said Travis Hamonic, like, ouch, that looked really bad. Like,
He's week to week now.
I know. It's one of those where you go, as much as maybe that's exciting for a moment, I also hate seeing one of the better defensemen on a team
let alone
knocked
Travis
out for
Hamonic.
Weeks. Travis Hamonic, dude of the century. We do love Travis Hamonic around here. Very mixed feelings.
I agree. It's a tough debate to take a side in with what we know, and that's like with any sport. Well, mainly two of them.
That's why you politely, passively clap.
You're like, okay, are you guys? Is everybody's everybody's arms and legs still moving? Is anybody concussed? Okay, great.
Yeah.
Glad that was done. I got a good question on Twitter. This is from Chris Faber. It's Thanksgiving, and this is a very good question. Which Thanksgiving dish is most comparable to Elias Pettersson, Elias Pettersson, or Eli Peterson? And I thought about this for a while, and
so did I.
You know, do you want to go first?
Sure. And I think it came out of a conversation you and I had the other day where I think he's just, you know, soft, fluffy, garlicky.
Are you talking about his complexion?
Mashed potatoes.
Where it's just the perfect.
Yes, they're like clouds in your mouth.
Are we all just going to say our favorite food? Is that what this is turning into?
You have Elias Pettersson who is, he is a surprise, and he's so enjoyable and so, like, we're just so happy with what he's, what he has been the first two games. So I think of it like when you go to somebody else's house for Thanksgiving and they do things differently than what you've had for so long, and then, like, they do stuffing or something differently and it's so much better than your family has made it. And you're like, why have, like, this is a completely different dinner now. I never thought that this little bit of stuffing would change the whole complexion of the meal. That's Elias Pettersson. He is a fancy, elaborate stuffing that you couldn't believe that you didn't have until now.
Mine is similar logic behind it. Mm-hmm. I may get, it's a polarizing dish at the table. So
cranberry
people,
sauce.
Which may be an appropriate comparison. It's not cranberry sauce.
Oh, thank God.
Because
I hate
some people are still
sauce.
Like, he should be in the AHL. He's too small. I've still seen tweets more from people outside of Vancouver.
Is he a tofurkey?
No.
Don't you dare say the Brussels sprouts.
I'm going to say oven roasted Brussels sprouts with bacon, which is one of my favorite. And Brussels sprouts, I know some people hate them.
Yeah.
But if they're done properly, they can be the best food on that table.
Brussels sprouts used to be done terribly, much like undersized.
Just steamed or boiled?
That's
no.
Right.
And that's how it undersized Swedish forwards with skill were like in the
so
past
true.
NHL. No, we don't need that. They're not ready. You know, no, come on. I don't want that at this table. But now you change the game a bit. You put some bacon on there. You cook them a bit differently. All of a sudden, that undersized Swedish forward, the Brussels sprout.
They didn't overcook them. They roasted them just the right amount of time.
Yeah. All of a sudden, that Brussels sprout, that Swedish Brussels sprout is flourishing at the dinner table.
Thank you for making
well
my
done.
Point for me. But yes, I'm all about the
I didn't know if you were
going
to go there. I don't know if you were going to compare it to how undersized Swedish forwards were 10 years ago.
Ryan doesn't think I've been following hockey this summer. He knows
well,
that I turn hockey
Vermont.
Off for a few months.
You don't get cable
anyway,
in your cabin.
Pleasantly surprised with how well this has turned out. It's one of those dishes you don't know going into it. Is it going to be done right? Is it going to be cooked just the right amount of time, and it was.
Yeah.
For the first couple bites, anyway. We'll see how the rest of the serving goes. Yeah. By the end of it, it might be too much. Thank you for the belding laugh. Well,
that really made me chuckle, because it's such the perfect comparison, because I...
Yeah.
Oh, no. The first one, that was Mr. Belding to a T.
The first one was organic.
I'm sorry. I don't know what I was doing. It was just a reflex. But I remember the first time we had the differently cooked Brussels sprouts with the bacon and the oven roasted or whatever, and you're like, and I vividly remember that it was at my sister's house. I'm like, I don't know how I'm gonna like this. Look how shrimpy Pettersson is. I don't know if I'm going to like this, and we did.
So as always, Paul is right.
Well, and Dave,
when's that one again?
Well, luckily Dave is muted on Skype. That'd be so great if we didn't cut him off.
Pettersson is the turkey. He's the turkey. He's the main course.
I feel like he'd be like, no, Pettersson's the gravy.
No, Goldobin's the gravy.
You know whose nickname is Gravy.
I feel like Dave. You missed that joke.
Oh, that is Dave's nickname. We've called him Gravy for 10 years.
So he would definitely have said Gravy, yes.
The gravy's the best part of the meal.
It's always the best when you explain your joke.
Those are the best. The funniest ones, the funniest jokes are the ones you
got
to explain.
Early season form. We got this go. We're all reading off each other so well today.
I don't think Paul's going to do the Pettersson Russell Sprout bit properly. I'm going to have to cut him off. I got to cut him off and do it myself.
I was going to do a mic toss too, but Ryan went off about how the bat toss is the wrong move to make.
But so. You know who's the pie on the team.
Well, duh. Fresh out of Abbotsford, who apparently, according to Hockey TV, weighs 226 pounds, which I find shocking.
Yeah, he slimmed down, and then he's built the muscle on top of that.
I said that to you ages ago now in regards to Dave.
Oh, yeah. That's really funny. Matthias Fallman, new Patreon backer, he asked a tough question that we should give thanks to a member of each NHL team.
Each team?
And I couldn't. That would have taken
that's
hour.
That's forever. Have you listened to us talk? We can't do anything efficiently.
If I could, I will pick two obscure teams. Carolina. We're thankful they appreciate boys who like museums. Mm-hmm. Arizona, I'm thankful that they brought back the peyote coyote uniforms.
Okay.
And
I'm thankful that Gary Bettman put a team in Seattle. I don't thank Gary Bettman very often. It's kind of like Dave. Don't thank or agree with him very often. But when I do... It's earnest and from the heart. Thank you for putting a team in Seattle. It'll be fun for road trips.
All right, fine. I'll be thankful to those few fans that go watch games in places like Ottawa and Carolina and Florida.
And well, Kingston?
I'm thankful for the Ottawa Senators for constantly taking one step forward and four steps back, giving us pod fodder to talk about, because they dropped a bunch of heavy beach balls on the for the fans to bump around before the season opener.
They injured people and knocked beers over, allegedly.
Injured children.
Oh, dear.
So I just love what they I think Eugene Melnick's the only guy that works there now, and he's like, what's a good idea? Cracks a beer. Oh, I know it'll work.
And we've already covered this to great extent, but I am thankful that Elias Pettersson is going to make this season somewhat tolerable for those of us who have to go to so many games in person. I hope his dad's sitting up in the box next to me all season. That'd be a good time.
Jeez, get him on the show.
How long before you talk to him?
I'm gonna look him up.
6 years.
Actually, Ryan, you had a great tweet where it was just like, my son has two goals, or he's informing the fellow patrons at the Saddle Dome of how many goals his son has this season. That was when he scored his first in the second game. And then I saw somebody took the same screen grab where he had the two fingers up, but it looked like he was pointing to his eyes. Says, Elias is the captain now. And I just thought, that is brilliant.
I love that.
Whoever did that on Twitter.
You're thankful
I liked
for
it.
That.
I'm thankful for them and their clever quips.
Well, we're thankful for you listening this week. And as always, we make sure you, we're thankful that you follow us on Twitter at pucks.netca or pucks.netca.
Ka?
And we're also thankful for those that support the show with a couple of bucks, a couple of hard earned dollars, and, over at patreon.com/pucks.net. And you can do that. And after this, we're going to talk about something on 5 Minutes or Paying. Probably the Fantasy Hockey League, because all the Patreon backers are in the Pucksnet Fantasy League, and that is not the fantasy stats rule does not apply to Patreon. So we'll probably talk about that for a bit. And we're also thankful for everybody that has...
Well, no, you had to become a backer to be a part of the league. So everyone's invested.
We gave priority to backers. I think everybody in the league is a backer except for one or two people. I'm not 100% sure, but somebody sent email money.
Mm. Everyone had to pay one way or another.
We will expand to 32 teams next year.
We're thankful for everybody in that league and that supports the show monetarily, and we're thankful for those that tell friends and help spread the word of the show. We're thankful for those that rate and review the show on iTunes, and we're not thankful for the Steve Jobs algorithm, but we're thankful that you guys leave positive ratings and reviews to help defeat it, help us get promoted. And if you haven't done that yet, we'd be very thankful and grateful if you did. And we'll also be thankful if you go to our Facebook page and like that, even though nobody uses Facebook anymore. And we'd be really thankful if you like the Instagram page, too. And go on to the pucksonnet.ca. This is the part of the show where I just talk to myself, and it sounds like this, because Geeta and Paul just kind of wait for me to finish. Go to pucksonnet.ca, and you can read my post about the Calgary Flames and how they're going to be good this year. And that's about it. You have anything else?
No.
How is this podcast still going? We've been recording for like 90 minutes. You don't know at home, folks, but there's like 40 minutes Ryan has to cut after because we were all just inappropriate to no end.
Man, I hope Paul doesn't tell me to cut out that inappropriate part. It was really funny. But then midway through those 40 minutes, I realized that it was offensive. Or was it?
I really wanted to say I was thankful for Jason's butt sub, but no one wanted to hear that.